you could spend a moment with some remarkable people and discover what their life sounds like, what would you ask? Welcome to Are We On Air? An audio encounter. I'm Armand Nafei, and each episode will feature one conversation with an inspiring friend of mine who will share with us the soundtrack to their life. Merhaba, and welcome back to another episode of Are We On Air? This week's guest is none other than my dear friend, the wonderful photographer, artist, musician, and gin maker, Mert Alas. Mert and I know each other sporadically over the past few years, bumping into each other at, you know, hotels, places, cities, parties, events, anything fun. And over the past year and a half, we even got to work together, mainly on his brand new gin called 71. But before we jump into the gin situation, let's talk about who Mert is. You might know him under Mert and Marcus, two photographers who are known for the past 20, 30 years of being the fashion photographers. From Bjork to Madonna to Dua Lipa to the who's who of everything and everybody they've worked with, and there are plenty of fun stories to come. But we also discovered that Mert, growing up in Turkey, studied piano, and I can tell you firsthand what a beautiful pianist he is. Usually at the end of the evening, after a couple of gins and wonderful and fabulous people at a wonderful and fabulous soiree, he jumps on the keys and plays a little solo. Well, we also talked about our shared love of Turkish music. As you might know, I love Turkish music, especially from that period, the psychedelic period, psychedelic rock of the late 60s and early 70s. And I'm sure I've talked about this before, but we also got to chat about one of our new exciting talents that are coming out of Turkey, well, I guess slash Holland, is Altin Gün, who we also had on the show in season one. Anyway, let's get to it. I hope you'll enjoy it, and I'll speak to you soon.
So, hi, Armin. What a pleasure to be with you today.
Yes, I mean, I wish we would do this in person, obviously, because, you know, we have a lot of fun always together. But, you know, COVID it is. I'm in Los Angeles, you are in London. I love that when you were in Los Angeles, I was in Berlin. But we had a wonderful time in Ibiza together.
Yes, it was great. And I wish we could have paused that time and no other variants came up. And I mean, it was great, but it is what it is. So we just have to face the music as we do and dance, but this time dance alone.
Bedroom dancing only. So, oh my God, what's going on? You are in London, you're in your studio right now, I guess?
Yes, I'm in my studio, I'm in London. I'm actually doing my last day at work, just wrapping up stuff and trying to finish as much as I can so they don't bother me while I'm away. And yeah, so I guess the next step of this is the luggages.
Well, the fun part. Well, one fun part is, of course, one love of ours is music that we both share. I love talking about music with you, even though you come from the visual world. I think music is also plays a big role in your life. And obviously we work together. Well, not obviously, we do work together on your beautiful gin 71, where, you know, we do beautiful soundtracks and parties around that.
Yes, we did great music together.
Yeah, I mean, I loved our little moment in Ibiza this summer when we were playing, I call it the Turkish santur.
Yes.
What's the instrument called in Turkish?
Which one?
The one we were playing early in the evening at the 71 party.
I think it was kanun.
Kanun.
Yeah, it was it's an amazing instrument. It's like, it reminds me of my childhood because obviously as a child, we have this like a very popular tavern culture where we go to taverns with families you know, and friends of the mom and dads. They're like four families go together, like 20 people on the table, kids on one side and the grown-ups on the other side, and they're like a star of the night would come out and sing, and there will always be kanun. So it really reminds me of that sort of the 80s period where I was forced to go to those places because there was no nannies then.
Well, I guess that was your earliest significant musical memory then, yeah. Like that shaped you.
Yeah, I mean, my significant music memory that shaped me as an artist, I guess, is my school, because I studied at the National Art, Classical Music and Art College in Turkey, in a conservatoire, and I was being trained to be a cellist and pianist. So my introduction to music was in a very classical way, and I loved it. And of course, in those days, you had to stay in the school in dormitories. So I would spend 5 days of the week in the school, and then 2 days, your family would come and pick you up and you go back to the home, your hometown. And so you kind of like, you know, spend almost all your childhood there since I was 11, and I would be in the school. So it's a very sort of a very exciting and very, very colorful memories of music for me. It shaped me as an artist in a way. Mm. And, you know, like these nights that we used to sneak off, we had to sleep and the dormitories would be shut by 9 p.m. So you had to be in after the dinner. And then you go to bed and the doors will be locked. So then, you know, you cannot get out. You cannot, like, wander around the school. But, of course, we would always find ways and, you know, climb the roofs and going through windows from balcony to another balcony and so on. And then you would have the whole school for you with, like, four or five friends of us, of me. So we would, like, go to the concert hall, you know, start playing with the concert piano and... You know, as kids, that's like a kind of almost like, you know, Nightmare on Elm Street kind of, you know, very, very fearful, but also very exciting thing. And then, are we going to get caught? Is there ghosts in the concert hall and so on? So my childhood, I say my childhood, really was enlightened by my school. And in a way, it really shaped me the way I am, the way I think, the way I approach to everything in my work. It began there.
How would you describe yourself with three records or three tracks that define who you are?
Wow, that's an ambitious question, Armin.
It is. And no one says, oh, great, let me tell you. Everyone says the same thing. I don't know.
Well, I guess, how would I describe it? I would say Elegy by Gabriel Fauré. I would say it's a beautiful cello piece, which I played when I was a kid. I have to say Geçer by Sezen Aksu. I have to. It is what it is.
Why?
Well, it's like I think it was about, it was the first time I felt love and the first time I was heartbroken and it was sort of a, and she was there and she somehow, I mean, you're kind of like a heartbroken when you're born in Turkey from the day one. Gönlüm düşürce aşka Her ayrılık aynı Yalnız kişi
işler başka. Her ayrı yalnızlık, aynı tanıdık telaş. Her ayrı, her şey ayrı. Sanki birbirine.
That's what they teach you. It's like a good man is heartbroken. So, you know, our songs are all about love and separation and pain and suffering and, you know, going through everything, every kind of pain for love. And so we really value love. We really value pain of love. Almost like more pain you suffer for love is the more bigger your love. So in those days, that song was very strong for me, very important for me. And I kind of really still listen to it a lot. I still listen to everything she does. She is my Middle Eastern spirit mama, I guess. Like when I miss my country, when I miss my food, when I miss my mom, when I miss Turkey, when I miss Istanbul, it's just me and her together in my head. And if even maybe I'm driving or so on. So Sezen Aksu is very important. Therefore, I would say she kind of does make a piece of me. It's very hard now. I guess Bjork, Big Time Sensuality, because it was the time that I just moved to London. Freedom, as in being alone without family, without rules, just being myself, making my own rules, making my own life, choosing my own hair color, being able to put...
What nail color was that?
Pale baby blue. You know, and then in one of those nights, and I was out, this girl came up to me. She said, would you like to share a drink with me? And I was like, I'd love to, because I guess I must have looked sad or poor or whatever, I don't know. And she just gave me some drink. I had a sip and she said, to have some more. I said, okay, I'll have some more. And then we start talking. And then I just realized, I said, oh, you Bjork. So I was like, oh my God, like I just met Bjork. And it was so incredible. Actually, in the 90s, that was very cool, where we were not pushed around into like the VIP rooms and, you know, selected things. And it was like almost everyone in the same place and everyone is together. And some is an artist, some is a, you know, kid who works at the pizza shop, and some is a, you know, a musician is up and coming, and some is a taxi driver and so on. It was all about what you have to offer me that night. And which was all about your personality. So that's the things that I guess I was just introduced to in the early 90s. So for me, it was a life-changing moment, coming from Turkey and being on my own without a family, without rules, without everything. And that song was really like, for me, it kind of explains everything of that moment, you know, the clothes I used to wear, and you know, the feeling I used to feel when I, you know, wanted to go out. And when I was walking on the street, when I was walking down Soho, I was part of that period. So I guess it's important for me to say the other part of me is that song.
What a chance. I mean, I guess we all had these chance encounters in our lives, but how amazing. Bjork must have been at her height of her career.
Just and then I remember going back to her house and she said, "Do you like the sound of harp?" I said, "Yes, I love harp. I used to be a musician in Turkey." And then she started playing harp to me and we became friends. Wow. And then we start going out all the time. Every Friday I would call her and say, "Are we doing something?" And she would be like, "Okay, let's get dressed." And it was all about getting dressed. It was all about character making, you know, like, who am I going to be this Friday night? So, it was an important period. Mm.
Yeah. I had this conversation with some friends actually last night over dinner. I mean, I got the end of the height of London. I moved to London in the early 2000s, so which was the end of this era. But even back then, I'm sure you remember, like, Family and Dalston Superstore and all these parties where, you know, not enough of these kids had money, but it was the effort and the energy and everyone's just excited for they're all in there for the same cause. It was that kind of just being who they are and just enjoying the moment, you know, that created this energy.
In many occasions, I remember meeting people that was very interesting, because for me, like, someone who dressed up really well, who had a extreme self-expression in her look and the way they danced, their hair color. I always associated them, I guess, with like someone who's either musician or artist. But when you in the 90s would go out and meet people, I literally remember someone saying to me, "Oh, I'm a chef assistant," or "I'm this, I'm that." It's kind of like a very non-fashionable jobs, and they looked like, you know, incredible. So it was almost like, you know, we had to express ourselves to be accepted by certain people, and our attire, our nails, our hair, our dirty jean, or our, you know, PVC, whatever, trousers and so on, they were an expression of our personality. So you created you, you know, you created yourself, and you, and it was far, far away. I remember once sort of going into this place, and then my friend said, "Oh, that girl's wearing like a Gucci shoes, or sorry, a Prada shoes or something." And I was like, "Oh, what is that?" Like, honestly, we were like so far away from it. So I missed that for a very long time, but I think I am actually meeting now crowds, that kids that are very similar. I'm seeing a very interesting change in the young generation. There are now a lot of self-expressive kids, which really excites me.
Mm. Yeah, I mean, these things go through phases, I guess. And yeah, that's the currency.
We can't be just nostalgically sad about our present time, because that's all we've got. So we kind of have to
now.
We have to find bits and bobs to you know, and also or we have to shape it and make it better. You know, we have to say, "Look, guys, let's," like, for example, whenever I do a party, I make sure everyone dresses up. I said, "Listen, this is when you dress up." So
I mean, sometimes you also need that encouragement for people. It's like, now is the time to make the effort, because sometimes you can also think, "I'm overdressed," because nothing else happens around you, right? Yeah. So you kind of acclimatize to the to your surroundings. But I like this approach of, like, it's Friday night and we're dressing up, and what character are you going as? That I can see that in your work, that you as a photographer, that you, Mert Marcus, basically are doing. You create these, like, scenarios, these worlds, these images. So I guess this has influenced your photography in a way, or maybe vice versa. But yeah, you guys been doing this for more than 30 years, yes, by now.
29 years,
yes, wow. So next year we're throwing a big party next year.
Yeah, I'm burning everything up.
All the photos, all the catalog, everything's going around in the trash. It didn't exist. But what were some of the most memorable shoots that you had, and what was playing?
There's always some early Madonna on set, for sure. Like, it really makes me kind of start feeling like the fashion, and if the subject is fashion. And then some 90s deep house I really like when I'm on a roll and I don't need to discuss anymore. I don't need to talk to hair or makeup or anyone else in the set. I'm just like, I'm connected to model. And now we're going to kind of like, we know what we're doing and let's just like roll around and do pictures. Then I love deep 90s house, super loud. And especially like if it's getting into a late night and it's past 12 midnight, I love hard music. Then sometimes I may need some more romance or strange or atmosphere or, you know, something that it's more darker, more mysterious moment. And I need to maybe ignite something in the model's mind and my spirit. So I then go to a, you know, weirder songs or even like some old sad classical music or even Yima Suma. You know, I'm the most eclectic music lover you'll ever see.
After me, yes.
Exactly. Oh yes.
I mean, no, that's I love that. I mean, that's, I think also our tastes are similar because of that. It's the, you know, music has to, in my opinion, I guess in yours as well, kind of be a soundtrack of our lives and have, yeah, different shades and facets, and that goes with it. But
some music gives us messages, you know, tells us lyrical stories, and some music is just punctuates our spirit and our soul. And I love that. I love the soul. I love the beat music. I love the beat. Sometimes more than lyrics, in fact. You know, I like the beat, the music, the instruments, and it's sometimes I don't even know, like an Italian song that I love, the song, I don't know what she's saying, but I love it because I love it, because my soul likes it. Mm. So I kind of respond to music in that manner.
Yeah, I hear and feel you and see you.
Ancora tu. Non mi sorprende, lo sai. Ancora tu. Ma non dovevamo vederci più. E come stai? Domanda inutile. Stai come me. E ci scappa da ridere. Amore mio, mangiato o no. Ho fame anch'io, e non soltanto di te.
Did you ever discuss, I mean, you're very good friends with Madonna, and of course, she's a great supporter of 71 Gin as well. Did you guys ever discuss her music? Like, did you ever, like, talk, did you tell her that you use her music to get you going?
She
knows, because you obviously work together as well, but...
Yeah, she knows. Whenever we party, I always try to put some old music, and she's like, she knows, and... Actually, we talk a lot about music. I'm one of the... a few people that has the honor to actually always give my opinion to the song when it's finalized before it's released. You know, I would go to the studio, she would play me, and I would say, "Are you sure about the strings here? Or do you think you need more pause there?" And so on. You know, we would like comment, and then you know, she would sort of say, "Oh, fuck you." but then she would change it, you know, she would say, "Hey, I changed it." Or, you know, so yes, I have a very much very musical relationship with her also. Like sometimes we go and then she would say, "Can you play some piano for us?" And then I would stay and play piano.
I love that when you play your piano.
Thank you. And then or sometimes her daughter Mercy would like do a little small home recital for us, and she would sing, and then we talk about music. It's very musical with her, you know. Music is not really like a business. It's her life, so it's great.
Dave, if you can just pick one Madonna track to play, which one would that be that you play at your shoots? Maybe
I would love to play Get Into the Groove. Get Into the Groove.
Get into the groove, boy. You got to prove your love to me. Yeah. Get up on your feet. Yeah. Step to the beat. What will it be?
Done.
I mean, I like most of them, actually.
Yeah, of course.
You know, when I get ready, sometimes I play, you know, Express Yourself. You know, there's so many good ones.
Of course. But when you prepare for a shoot, do you create like audio mood boards? Like, or does it, like, how do you prepare for a shoot? Like, you come up with a theme, or talk me through the process of you guys
shooting? Several, but there's not always an intention. For example, we are doing a shoot for Armin's magazine, and then Armin would come and say, "Hey guys, would you like to do this shoot with us for disc collections?" And then we would go away and think about what that could be. And if it's excited to us and if it's inspired us, then we would start, you know, planning. And we would say, okay, who should we cast? Okay, let's cast, a model. And then what should she be? Who should she be? How should she act? What her hair should be? What her manners should be, what should she wear? And then, oh, where should she be? What the light should be? Is there anyone else in the picture? Is she looking at the camera? You know, all these like a conversational pre-production, conceptual pre-production meetings we go through. And then once we decide what we are doing, then we would basically get on the set. There's some, of course, ready prepared playlists throughout the years. You know, like there's an 80s playlist, there's a rock playlist, there is classical, there's Turkish, there's, you know, there's a lot of playlists there. But I'm actually very much about, I'm a very spontaneous artist regardless. I'm very spontaneous. I could be preparing for a shoot all week, and then I will come on the set. For some reason, I would say, oh, that didn't work. Are we going to turn left and shoot this white wall? That was not our plan. So music is also like that for me. I could be doing something and I could suddenly scream and say, hey, put Iggy Pop, I put Iggy Pop now. Yes, there are pre-prepared playlists, but like I respond to the day's subject, I guess music is part of the subject, part of the job. So that evolves and changes as well as we change throughout the day.
I can see the connection to your Turkish heritage now even more. I mean, obviously I'm Persian, so I also understood what you were saying early on, how man and the suffering element to it, you know, and how we are in our music. It's all about, it's beautiful. It's not in a negative way.
Not
way
at all.
You would say.
Not at all.
It's so beautiful. It's more passion. Yeah.
Totally.
It's pure love. Yeah. But how much of your Turkish heritage do you attribute to your work?
I guess I wish I have a measuring system, but I don't. What I could say though is there's ingredients of making me, I guess, and some part of it is Turkey, some part of it is here, but there is a lot of. I think I got my romance and my passionate side from my heritage and my desire for craft and beauty and romance is probably coming from Turkish heritage, I would say.
Do you listen to contemporary Turkish music as well, like pop music? I love Turkish music, by the way. I think in the Orient, Turkish music is the best. It's the strongest, better than Arabic or Persian, in my opinion. There's just I don't know. There's just so much. It's a bit more refined, and I don't want to say it in a negative way to the others, but it's. I think there's just more history. There was less limitations. Artists were able to experiment, yeah. I think, in the past, at least, more freely than in Arab countries or Persian or in Iran.
I don't know so much about the Arab countries or Persian music, to be honest with you. But I guess what I remember lately, I was doing some researches on Turkish music, and I came across some psychedelic rock bands in the 60s and 70s.
The best. Yeah.
And I was like, oh my God, this is like really. And I have like friends that are very inspired by psychedelic and rock music and so on. I was just talking about that to one of them, and he said, oh, are you talking about Boris Manço? I was like, oh my God, how did you guys
know
all this? Yeah, I did know, but I didn't know that he was popular in Italy, for example. Yeah, and contemporary, I just start listening to this band, and I heard a couple of their songs, which I liked because they're sort of revamp.
Altıngün,
yeah. They revamped the kind of old amazing songs. And
out of season
and
one.
Some of the songs, yeah. There's some of the songs they play, they are actually very old Turkish folk songs. So they actually modernize them and make them their own way. And then they also play some psychedelic rock from the 70s. And they're pretty cool. I like them.
They're great, and yeah, I think that's the beauty of the internet and streaming, and also these re-releases that all these like Turkish psychedelic rock legends were kind of rediscovered. Like
yeah.
I remember the first time I heard of it was like I think 2007 or 2008. I was in some record store in Williamsburg back then, and I was in the store. And I was like, "What is this that you guys are playing?" And it was a re-release of Ersin. You remember Ersin?
Ersin and Dadaşla.
Şişesini saran bulunmaz bulunmaz, yıkma hakkın binasını ören bulunmaz bulunmaz. Ey güzel dost nereden gelin, eyleni eyleni leni. Gelir Hüseyin'im göçü dolanı dolanı lanı. Sinem göz göz oldu yare, bu yare kimler sara? Tabip gerek derman sara, derman bulunmaz bulunmaz. Aşk perişandır şaşkına, hak yardım eyle düşküne. Mecnun gibi dost aşkına, ölen bulunmaz bulunmaz.
Oh my god. You know, so that was
incredible.
My entry.
Really incredible.
Yeah, and that was my entrance into that world. And actually, I think I must have said that at my interview with Altıngün like a year and a half ago, I guess. But I had this moment in Amsterdam where there's, of course, Amsterdam and Holland has an amazing music scene and it's very open-minded, you know, also because of their story and history. And I was at this really cool festival, a small boutique, but I've never seen so many beautiful and cool-looking people in my life at a festival.
Really?
And the head, yeah, and in the head, it was Strange Sounds from Beyond, the festival was called. And the headline, it was 2-3 small stages, but the headliner at 10 p.m. in the pouring rain was Zelda.
Şehirde ojeli parmakları yazma, bir de bizim köyde nasırlanmış elleri de. Yaz, yaz gazeteci yaz, yaz, yaz efendi yaz. Yaz, yaz gazeteci yaz, yaz, yaz efendi yaz. Bankada parası olan kulları yazma, onları aldanıp yolundan azma. Şehirden asfalt geçen yolları yazma, bir de bizim köyde geçmeyen.
An 85-year-old Turkish woman who's looks like an old nana with like an amazing band behind her, and the place was packed. Like people were in the pouring rain waiting for her. Like all day, festival was cool, and everyone was waiting for her, and they were raging. And for me, it was just like mind blowing. I was like,
yeah,
what is happening?
They did like several years ago. They did one of her songs. They sort of like did a retake on it. I don't know if you heard that. It's very, very good.
The Acid Pauli remix?
Yeah, it's incredible, no?
Yeah. Yeah, amazing.
Yeah.
It's beautiful. But you hear the suffering in the voice, in the lyrics.
Yeah,
so that's exactly what it is. That's why people connect to it. They don't speak the language. I don't speak the language, but you feel it. But yeah. But I think one thing that we of course love and share is your delicious gin, 71 gin.
Yes.
Tell me about where that idea of the gin came from, and also what tracks defined you. Oh, actually, you know what? Let's rephrase this. Let's tell me the story of the gin, but what would you play if you have one glass of the drink, and what would you play if you have five glasses?
Oh, I like where you're going with this.
I mean, tell our listeners that I was there when you had one glass and then when you had five glasses.
I mean, 71, it was an ode to my love to a nightlife, really. And also the nightlife that I fantasized in my head and adored when I watched movies when I was a kid. And anyway, it was about nightlife that full of colorful people, creative people, people that has few words to say, and it is not about a status, but it's about self-expression. This is all became the DNA of 71 in a way, subconsciously, because obviously when you do something, you do something in your own way, it's your point of view. And so when I decided to do the gin, I was like, oh, what kind of gin should it be? What kind of glass should it be? What kind of, you know, place should it be? It all then made sense. What I was doing, I was actually doing an ode to the nightlife that I had in my head and bringing that back. So it was not really about a partying and going crazy and drinking like senselessly. It was about having a very fine martini. It was about having a very good drink with a very good glass and a good piece of ice and talking to someone and getting amused by a poet or, you know, listening to an amazing musician and so on. So when I was building 71, for me, that was very important, that the creativity and also perfection that I fighted for the 30 years of my career and the perfection that I love about arts, artists, and women, men, music, it had to have all of this in a bottle. So it's a very decadent product, I think, very decadent piece. I think for me it represents self-indulgence and... Whenever I drink it, I love listening to many things. I love listening to Rolling Stones.
So you stretched out in room 1009 with a smile on your face and a tear out in your eye. Oh, come see, get a line.
I love listening to Blondie. I I love listening to, I don't know, like anything that it has the moment. For me, what's more important is who I share that moment with. It was made for me and my friends. I'm very, very friend-based person. I'm very family person. And I wanted to make something for that, actually, for them. And it started with that. So we would get together and gather together. We would put some great music on and we would put a Freddie Mercury, and we would put these great glasses and we start talking. We start talking about life and the politics and art, and, you know, we would start fighting and discussing and so on. So I loved it. And then I thought, you know what, I'm going to expand that. So it's a piece of me.
You're DJing at your 71 party. I love your 71 parties. They all look very fabulous and chic, and you have fabulous people there. And I think most alcohol brands who see that, they must be so envious. What you guys put together in, what, 6 to 12 months? Like, the campaigns look, of course, beautiful and delicious. I mean, that's like your home turf. But then, of course, the celebrity endorsements, because they're your friends and family, so we wouldn't even call it endorsements, because it's just part of the home. And of course, the fun parties and soirees that you and Tasso have been hosting. Both of us,
like me and Tasso, we both love hosting. So before the gin, we were hosting. And now the gin, we're hosting it even more, and we love it. We love seeing friends, and all my friends also love this kind of nights, smaller nights. It's never like 100 people. Smaller nights, we come together, we drink, we talk, and sometimes we watch a movie together, all together in the movie room. Sometimes we listen to music, sometimes we sing. It's like, it's, you know, it's our like a little social club.
Yeah, the anti-social club.
I'm joking.
All right, so you have a glass of 71, you're getting ready for a night out. What track are you putting on that gets you going?
Getting ready to go, Freddie Mercury, Don't Stop Me Now. That literally, I put that in the shower. And even if I'm tired, I'm totally ready to go out. So that's literally my shower music and getting ready music.
Don't stop me, don't stop me, don't stop me.
Hey, hey, hey!
Don't stop me, don't stop me. Ooh, ooh, ooh.
I like
don't stop
it.
Me, don't stop me.
Have a good time, good time.
Don't stop me, don't stop me.
Oh.
Love it, shower music. I love that. Well, when you're not out and about, I think true craft requires patience and time, right? And and you know, we just came out of, you know, a couple of lockdowns, and it's winter time now again. How important is silence and solitude to creativity?
Silence and solitude, basically. I am not really a very creative in so much solitude, because I guess I'm a single child and I love audience. I love supporting team, okay? and almost like I need to talk to them and then say, oh, this red or that red. Oh, this red, you like this red? Okay, it must be the other one then. So, you know, kind of a, I do like the chaos. I do like the noise. I'm not one of those silent, calm artists where I have to be, you know, wear sneakers and be very quiet and everyone needs to be quiet so I can create. It's completely opposite. I create from mess.
Yeah, I love it. Yeah, it's the color. We need the color. We need the exchange. What have you recently discovered in music, art, film, or fashion that caught your attention?
Recently, I heard this young girl called Nilüfer Yanya, very experimental music. She really is very interesting. She's got a beautiful voice, and she is. I love the fact that she's so experimental, and in the world of such a produced music, it felt very personal and raw, and I like it.
Throw it all away for you, just like you asked me to. You can always be my ways of time. And when things don't go to plan, if you deserve another chance, I can count on you to take your time.
So I came across an artist, Julie Meretu.
Oh, Julie! Yes, she was part of season 2.
The amount of detail and it's crazy. I didn't know her before, so yeah. Nilüfer and Julie is my two girls that I discovered lately.
I love it. I'll send you her playlist. Oh, listen to the episode. You're going to love it. Julie is amazing. She's
great.
Incredible.
I will.
Yeah. Yes. She's wonderful. Shout out to Julie. Hi, Julie.
Hi, Julie.
Yeah, you guys should be working together. Yes, I'm definitely going to introduce you guys.
Great.
Yeah, any gossip, any fun stories you can tell us from some of your past shoots? Do you have to accept some of, like, let's say some shoots or some artists and you're like, ugh, I don't really want to work with that person? Or do you just, at this point, choose whatever?
All the time. Daily. Yeah, I mean, you can't like everything.
Oh, wow.
I mean, yes, there are artists that you think there's connection, and there are artists that you don't. And that's the beauty if everything sounded the same and felt the same and it was valued the same, then we wouldn't work so hard to make things better. I don't know. Mm. But of course, I don't love everything, and some things I love, some things I don't. And I usually, especially in the last 10 years, really like to work with only people that I like to, I think there's a connection. And for me, the connection is either a personal connection, so it could be someone totally off the chart and there's nothing to do with me artistically, but personally, there's a connection. It's good enough for me. Or vice versa, where there's great art and I'm so respecting their art and they're not the most model-like person or, you know, but to me, it doesn't matter. For me, then I love something else there. Then it goes beyond aesthetics and it goes beyond, you know, generic beauty. It goes into a more spiritual and more creative, expressive beauty. And I love that as well. So it's actually very, very, very valuable moments when that happens. So I'm not going to give you who I said no to.
No, I don't want to hear that. It's okay. I don't want to put you in any compromising situation. Well, we're just following your social media. I think everybody knows you have fun with some people. Let's leave it at that.
Well, you know, some are more fun. Some nuts.
That's life. Going slightly more intimate and back to some music. What's your?
Oh, I was wondering when you were gonna get intimate.
After 571 gins.
Okay.
What's your go-to falling in love or heartbreak song?
Okay, don't laugh. But I am so into the... I used to be. But I'm sure if you play now, I probably will react the same way, into a point where all my friends, when I meet them like 20 years later, 30 years later, they're like, oh my God, do you listen to this still? Do you remember that song where you used to go crazy? I was like, which one? It's Stop by Sam Brown. It's like my like all-time like heartbreak song.
All that I have is all that you've given me. Did you never worry that I'd come to depend on you? I gave you all the love I had in me. Now I find you lied, and I can't believe it's true.
After the heartbreak or before the heartbreak, when you're falling in love?
I mean, when I'm falling in love, I think I am very creative in a way. So when I'm falling in love, I dive into myself and I start creating this imaginary scenario where I work to achieve as the story of that love. So therefore, I don't really know the music part of that. I'm much more involved about making that love story happen. So for me, I listened, for example, in my last experience, there was a lot of fado involved. There was a lot of Turkish music involved. There was a lot of Maria Bethania involved.
E que me deixa louca quando me beija a boca, minha pele toda fica arrepiada e me beija com calma e fundo até minha alma se sentir beijada.
So, you know, it depends. It depends on the situation. I mean, I don't fall in love with you know, with that same song. It's not like I don't have a fall in love song.
Yeah, I guess every person gets their own soundtrack.
Yeah.
Well, after the heartbreak, you're out and about in London town and feeling super sexy. What's the sexiest song?
The super sexy song. I mean, like I said, because there's this passion, romance, there's this painful side of love for me. It's also because of my origin, I guess sexiness also comes with that, you know. So even the like, for example, George Michael, Different Corner, right, the song. So I find that very sexy song, you know. Like, some people would probably think that's a very sad song, but it's actually, it's very, I find it very romantic. So I think for me, the sexiness goes sort of hand in hand with romance. So let's say I don't listen to Led Zeppelin when I feel sexy.
I'd say love was a magical flame. I'd say love would keep us from pain. Had I been there, I would promise you all of my life, but to lose you would cut like a knife. So I don't dare. No, I don't dare. I'm so scared,
Love it. Well, Mert, to wrap up our little chat, if your life would be a movie, what song would play in the end credits?
Wow. You know, I'm really not sure about that one. What would be the end credits? I guess my life was like, I always wanted a celebration. You know, it was always about celebration. So I probably would be the end of my world, my movie or my life to be like very, very much of a celebration moment. So I don't know. Maybe it's like Edith Piaf, Milord, something like, you know what?
Asseoir à ma table, il fait si froid dehors. Ici c'est confortable, laissez-vous faire, Milord. Et prenez bien vos aises, vos peines sur mon cœur, et vos pieds sur une chaise, je vous connais.
Or is, like a, or is it like a cabaret? is it like maybe this time? I don't know.
Maybe this time.
Love it.
I'll be lucky. Maybe this time he'll stay. Maybe this time, for the first time, love won't hurry away.
It's not Frank Sinatra, I Did It My Way, okay? No. Don't try to get that song off me.
I think cabaret is more fitting.
Yeah, totally. Meine Dames und Madame, Mesdames und Messieurs. Yeah, definitely is.
Nice. Well, Mert, it's been a real pleasure.
Armin, very nice talking to you.
Always.
And I wish we had this face-to-face, but one day we will.
We will meet one day, probably next month.
Exactly. So whenever you need some, you know, musical questions, I'm always here. And it was a pleasure talking to you.
Lady peaceful, lady happy, that's what I long to be. Well,
thank you for tuning in this week. If you want to listen to the full playlist, visit areweonair.com or our Spotify channel. You can also find us on Instagram and on YouTube at areweonair. And a big thank you to my wonderful team at Studio Noi. I'm Armand Nafei, and I'll speak to you soon.